How's everybody doing at COG today? All y'all blessed, huh? God is good. If I have y'all stand up, get ready for worship.
I was lost with a broken heart. Pick me up, now I'm set apart. From the ash I am. Forever safe in the Savior's seas. Where I'm born, the rest is safe. I follow you for all the days. Fix my eyes, finally. Forever free.
Free. You are the real affection.
slap you with a kiss, and my heart turns violently inside of my chest. Oh, I don't have the time to maintain these regrets.
Celebrate Sundays with you. I'm so grateful to be able to worship freely in our country. Amen. Freely in our country, which I'm grateful for. This is the first of the month, and our tradition is that we partake of communion. And I'm really excited about it. I've been watching with my kids and my wife a TV series called The Chosen. I don't know if you've seen The Chosen before, but it's a TV series of the life of Jesus. And we just finished watching when Jesus takes the water and he turns it into wine. And what I really thought was amazing about that is how, one, Jesus cares about small details in your life. I think too many ministers say he's into the big things. He's into just removing sin. But Jesus cares about weddings. You know, I looked at Sophia, I said, when you have a wedding, and let's hope for it later in life, but when you have a wedding, make sure you invite Jesus. And she's like, because he turns water into yummy grape juice? And I said, well, he not only does that, but there's something else going on there. You know, in her mind, it's water to yummy grape juice, but spiritually, the water was water basins. It was the common. It was the ordinary. It was stuff that was used to wash people's feet. And he took what was ordinary, and by the Spirit of God, he made it extraordinary. He made it holy. He made it perfect. In fact, the host there says, this is the best wine that I've ever had. You normally, they bring out the good wine first and the cheap wine later, but you have saved the best for now. And what I love about it, maybe you haven't caught it yet, but God takes our lives, which were ordinary, which were rejected, which were cast off. He says, I take your life, and when you allow me to infuse it with the Holy Spirit, I make you the best wine ever. I make you acceptable for the wedding banquet. I make you holy. And so I just want to invite you today, we're going to partake of communion together. This morning, I want you to understand what the work of the cross was, what the blood was. But Pastor, I was out last night. Pastor, you don't know what I did. Well, there's a place to ask for forgiveness. There's a place of repentance. But if you asked him to forgive you today, I want you to know that he cleans you. He takes your ordinary life and he makes you holy. And I need you to start believing it. I need you to, when you partake of these elements today, say, Jesus, your blood is enough. Paul writes in Colossians, I see you in the Father's sight. He says, I see you as holy, as blameless, as above reproach. My question is, are you going to see yourself that way? And that's what this is partaking is about. It's about taking the regular, the people that maybe you never got picked because you were always last place. Maybe you were never good enough. And he says, you're just ordinary, but when you allow me to come inside you, I make you extraordinary. Oh, man, this is amazing. I've done that twice, and it just hits me every time. You say, Pastor, why does it hit you? Because I'm ordinary. by the world's standards, I'm a nobody. But yet Jesus sees something different. And I begin to believe that. And I'm starting to partake in what he sees. It's crazy. I wish you'd believe it today. I wish you'd believe it. I love 1 Corinthians, the 11th chapter, the 23rd verse. The Apostle Paul writes this. He says, "For I received from the Lord that which I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'Take, eat. This is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me.'" Let us take of the Lord's body together. In the same manner, he also took the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." Let us drink of the new covenant together. Oh, hallelujah. You know, I love in some of the Gospels, it says after that last supper, they sang a hymn together. I'd love for all of us to stand and just continue to worship the Lord. If my prayer team can come forward, if there's something going on in your life right now that you need personal prayer for, they're going to be up here and available to pray for you. I want you to know that God is for you. He's not against you. I don't know what you're going through today. Maybe there's a struggle in a relationship. Maybe you're having trouble forgiving somebody. Maybe you need a job today. I know this, that God, he does the simple details. He takes a wedding and it should have been shame. And he said, "You know what? I'm going to take it and I'm going to make it into wine, the water." And he'll do that, the details in your life, if you just give it over to him. And so if there's something you need, come up for prayer. If not, I want to invite you to stand and continue to worship the Lord together with me. You know, there's something about creating an atmosphere of faith for us to believe for the miraculous. Amen. And as we worship together, I believe we create that kind of atmosphere. Amen. Let's worship together.
searched the world. But he couldn't feel me. Man's empty praise and treasures of faith are never enough.
There's nothing better than you. awesome God we serve. There is nothing greater than him. There is nothing, nothing greater than our God and our Lord. He is worthy of all our praise. Thank you, Lord. What an awesome God we have. Thank you, Father. We just want to honor you. We just want to worship you because you're such a good, good Father. Father, we just want to thank you for the privilege to come into your house this morning, to give you praise, to honor you, because you and only you alone deserve all the glory, all the honor, and all the adoration. Father, we thank you for everyone here this morning. Lord, I pray that you bless us this morning. Continue to cause your face to shine upon us and give us peace. Thank you, Father, because your word is true. That when the anointing comes, it breaks away the yoke of the enemy. Father, whatever burden every one of us is feeling this morning, we thank you for your anointing that has broken away the yoke the enemy put around us. We give you all the praise and all the honor. Father, at this time, we just want to pray a special prayer for our first responders, the fire people, the EMS, the police officers. Lord, we lift up every one of them before you. Even those in the military, Lord, we lift them up before you, Lord. They put their line in danger for our sake, Lord. We pray, Lord, that you bless every one of them. Keep them safe during this time of pandemic. Keep their families safe, Lord. Lord, we just lift up also the President of the United States of America. Lord, we pray a blessing over him and the White House, Lord. Lord, we pray safety and protection over them, Lord. Continue to keep them in your hands, Lord. Father, we pray wisdom to rule your people, Father. We pray, Lord, as he makes decisions on how to take us to the next step, Lord. Guide his steps, Father. We bless you, we honor you. We pray for all the governors, all the city leaders, city managers, city mayors, county judge, Father. We lift up every one of them before you, Lord. All the pastors, they are leaders of the society, Lord. We lift them all before you. Continue to bless every one of them. Keep them safe during this time, Lord. Bless their families, Lord. We thank you because you're such a good, good Father, Lord. Thank you for the hospital workers, Lord. We don't want to forget them, Lord. Lord, we pray safety over them as they watch over us and take care of the sick, Lord. Bless them and bless their families and keep them safe, Lord. We give you praise, we give you honor. Thank you for everyone here this morning, Lord. Bless us as we continue to worship you this morning. In Jesus' name we pray. And the people of God say, amen. Thank you. Go hug your family. Do a high five to your neighbors. And for those of us joining us over the Facebook, just hug your family. Amen. God bless you all. You may be seated.
Hallelujah. Well, I get the honor of taking up the tithes and offerings today. Amen. God loves a cheerful giver. Let me try that again. Maybe I didn't say it well. I get the honor of taking up the tithes and offerings today. Hallelujah. Exciting, exciting. There's something been stirring in my heart to preach on the prosperity of God and where we find that in Scripture. I necessarily haven't done that, and my grandfather is teaching today, and I don't want to take up your time, so I'm not going to do it today. But I wanted to talk specifically about three keys to partaking in God's prosperity. And many of you know the first one, that being a generous person, being able to give tithes and offerings, being able to give even beyond that, see somebody in the grocery store and buy their, being generous in all you do is one aspect of partaking in God's prosperity. But there's two other things that are important, and sometimes we forget that. The other thing I want to mention is stewardship, meaning God gives you a certain amount of resources, and he expects you to manage them well. It's hard to be blessed if you're going to click on Amazon more than you're bringing in an income. And I know many people are wanting a financial miracle, but they haven't partaken or been good stewards in what God has given them. And so God doesn't want to give you more resources because you'll just end up in more debt. Can I preach a little bit today? Can I do that? Paul was like, no. The last aspect of God's prosperity that many people miss, not everybody, but many people miss, and you'll find this in Proverbs. If you can see, I love to read the Proverbs at night. I usually read for the day before. I'll read the proverb of that evening. So if it's the 7th, I would read Proverbs 7 the night before. It's usually how I do it. But one of the aspects of God's prosperity that you find is this word called diligence. Let me break it down even more. Work. That when you're diligent about work, God will bless. Oh, no, I'm just working for the man. Well, that's not what Scripture says. Scripture says this: to do everything is not unto the man, but unto the Lord. Should I preach this service today, Paul? No. So when you get those three things in balance, you will partake in the prosperity of God. You are talking to a person today that I literally have tried to outgive God in my life. I'm not going to tell you what it is, because my outgiving is different than your outgiving, and my blessing may be different than your blessing. I got a minivan blessing. Like, I got four kids. Like, that's... Y'all struggling with... I got to preach that. That children are a blessing from the Lord. They're not a burden. That, society says they're a burden. One of the richest things you can do in life is have kids. I got to preach today. I'm sorry, Papa. I'm going to take your time. And so when you realize this, when you realize God's blessing by being a good steward, being diligent at your work, being generous, don't turn a blind eye to the poor, help people in your life, God will pour out His riches in abundance and grace. He'll do little things for you. He'll show up at your wedding, and you thought you were going to get shame and just have water. He turns it into wine. That's a whole nother preaching sermon. But He'll do small things. He'll bless you. He wants to do this in your life if you would trust Him in it. Amen? Is that it? Can I do that? If you need an offering envelope, I got to do the formalities. I did that first the last time. If you need an offering envelope, raise your hand. If you want to give online, we are a high-speed church that you can give online. Text that number. It's going to send you that link. You click on that link, and you can give through PayPal. You don't need an account to give through PayPal, but you do need like a credit card or a debit card or something like that. Also, on the special line on our offering envelopes, we're going to be giving to some organizations to help others through the hurricane. And so if you want to help out, I know many people have asked me, hey, how can we help out? We're taking up an offering for the special line this Sunday, and so we'll be giving to the communities of Orange and Lake Charles. And so just a blessing. We want to be a blessing to people. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. All right. All right. If we can bow our heads, ushers, can you come up, start walking up with the baskets? You can walk and pray at the same time. You don't have to stop. They always stop, and they got to, no, we got to be still. No, you can keep walking. We're just talking to Jesus. Father, we thank you so much. Father, we thank you that you give seed to the sower. God, you desire for us to be blessed. You desire for us to prosper. Show us witty ways to increase in our diligence, increase in our stewardship, increase in our generosity, God, so that we can partake in the things that you desire for us. In Jesus' name I pray, and the people of God said, amen. 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 Let's receive the offering. This is all I can bring. Doesn't need an introduction, but I'm going to give him one anyway. Many of you know him as Paul. If you were part of the old church, you know him as Pastor Dowdy. For me, I've been blessed to know him as my spiritual father. And he has really poured into me. I was speaking with a minister yesterday, and he said it must be a true blessing to have another minister come and pour into you so diligently. And I've been so grateful for my grandfather, my spiritual father. I'm going to just call him Daddy today. And but just his work and laboring to teach me how to pastor. And so can we honor the man of God as he presents the word today? Hallelujah.
Okay, let's all stand up. Everybody stand up. Amen. Now let's the scripture in Psalms says, clap your hands, all you people. Shout unto God with the voice of praise. Come on. Clap your hands, all you people. Shout unto God with the voice of what? Praise. Come on, you sound like a bunch of pansies. Come on, clap your hands. Shout. Shout. One more time. Clap your hands. Shout. Shout. All right, real good. Turn to somebody. Just look at them. Tell them, bless them. All right, you may be seated. Amen. Well, if you have your Bibles today, let's get them out. I like Bibles. Now, I like that stuff up on the screen, but I can't see that back there, even with my glasses. So I bring a Bible. How much you know a Bible's really good to have? Amen. And if you get your Bibles, turn to John 14. John 14. And we'll look at the first six verses in a few minutes. And then mark it, if you will, and go to Revelation chapter 21 and 22. All right, now mark these, if you will, please. Just get them out. How many of y'all got a Bible? I don't want you to raise your hand because some of you don't. How many of you got an iPhone? How many of you got a telephone? Whatever that thing is, iPhone, you know, what all those things are. Get it out and look at it and look at the scriptures. You know, the reason I like my Bible when I go to church is because I can underline things. Because the preacher is bound to say something I like. Amen. And it'd be good. It'd be a blessing. All right, now today I'm going to talk to you about heaven. I hadn't heard a sermon on heaven since the last time I preached one. And no, I'm just joking. I've heard them. But it's good. Now, I had the privilege to be the founder of the church, Trey's grandmother, who's deceased. Her and I started the church, and we started in a tent. We stayed 2 years and 8 months in a tent, built a platform. And we'd have church on Sunday morning, revivals on Sunday night. And the people would come and fill that place up on Sunday night. They'd come in bathing suits. They'd come all kinds of garb. It was just a revival time. A lot of people got born again. It was a great time. And so, again, I'm used to standing here preaching. I'm used to giving the word of God. And so let's go to the Lord in prayer and ask these blessings upon us. Father, we thank you and we bless you. We thank you for the goodness of God in the land of the living. And Father, I do pray for every person, that includes myself. I pray that we'll be at peace with ourselves today, that the emotions that we've had to struggle with maybe in the past week, all the fear and anxiety that wants to come upon people in this today's climate, I just pray that peace will rest upon them today. And that the peace of God that passes all understanding will abide in our hearts by the Holy Ghost. Now, we thank you that every person that hears the voice of God today by the word of God, that, Father, if they're out of sort with God, they'll repent, get back into it, that they'll walk faithfully with God and find the truth of God's word in their heart. And so we're going to thank you and bless you for this. We ask it in Jesus' name, and all God's people said what? Amen. Amen. Now, here a few weeks back, it's probably not over a month ago. Well, it's actually been about 3 months ago when I started it because I preached 10 weeks. He said I preached 9, but I preached 10. He can't count. He never could get that up to 10. But whatever it was a great time. He took a survey in the church, and they asked what they wanted to hear on Wednesday night, and they said on end-time doctrine. In other words, the coming of the Lord, the rapture, the things that's coming in the future. And I don't say I'm the best at it, but I'm very good. I study the Word of God. I love the study. The Bible says, study to show yourself approved unto God, a workman that needeth not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. And so when you study, you learn. And remember, think about this now. When you come to church on a regular basis, you're taking in knowledge. You're just taking in knowledge. But if you ever notice yourself, one day you'll shake your head and say, I understand that. And what comes out of that is wisdom. Knowledge produces wisdom. So if you don't study, you won't have wisdom, or you'll have stupid wisdom. I didn't get any reply on that. Because you're looking at television, Facebook, you're looking at all the false news, maybe true news, you listen to all that stuff, and that's what you put out. But if you take in the Word of God, and you take it in, then you give out wisdom. And the wisdom of God changes people's life. You know, I don't say this braggingly, but I say it with fact. There's been tens of thousands of people born again simply because of this church. His father, we had a crusade in the Philippines, his father did. And over 5,000 people came to know the Lord in that particular crusade. We had about 30,000 people. I've seen the blind eyes open. I've seen the dead raised. I've seen miracles beyond words that you could even comprehend. So consequently, and I'm not talking about just a few hundred people. I've seen them by the thousands come to know the Lord. So I've had the privilege of doing a lot more than you probably will ever get to do. But if you'll just tell one person, that'll make a difference. Now, the last time I preached on end time, I took about 15 minutes and told you some up-to-date news. But then I'd had I've been a chaplain at the Galveston County Sheriff Department for, this is my 44th year. And so consequently, it gave me, thank you very much, it gave me the opportunity to lead hundreds of people to the Lord inside of a jail, which is a pre-hearing of going to prison if you go. And so consequently, I've had a great time. And I'm a soul winner. I like to win people to Jesus. I like to lead people to Jesus. There's nothing better. I've had them sleep on my front porch. When I get up, they tell me, would you tell me about Jesus? I've had them show up in all kinds of conditions. I had two men wanting to shoot. They were right over here shooting at each other, at each other's feet. And I led them both to the Lord. And so consequently, if you'll just go in Jesus' name, there's rewards for doing that. And so the Wednesday night that I preached, the last one that I preached, I spent about 15 minutes on the coming of the Lord, some of the things I needed to finish up with. But then I was marrying a deputy sheriff who knew the Lord. He loved the Lord. And God put a message in my heart that there's rewards for serving Jesus. In other words, there's rewards for doing what you're doing. There's a reward for playing the music, serving as servants, being elders. There's rewards of pastoring. There's rewards for all the things that we do. You know, in this life, there's a lot of rewards. There's the Oscars and the country music reward and the bebop reward and all kinds of crazy music that they have today, to me, kind of crazy. But all the things, there's rewards. And, you know, people get honored and all that kind of stuff. Now, that will pass away. You know, I've been honored in a lot of things, but that won't last. But the things that will last forever is the rewards you get from Jesus. Now, there used to be a pastor friend of mine that when he had on his recorder, the answering machine, I guess what you call them, or answer, whatever it is. And he said, hello, this is Wally Hamilton speaking. And remember, there's a reward for serving Jesus. I never forgot that. Now, I know that. There'll be some that have gold, silver, and precious stone. There'll be some that they just get there and they'll just be barely saved. They won't know nothing. Some of them are saved, yes, so is by fire. The Bible says some people will just get there, just get there. But you and I that love the Lord, I want rewards. You said that's selfish. No, it's not. I want a reward for serving Jesus. And I gave you the crowns that we'd have. And there's five of those crowns. One is the victor's crown, and that's keeping our flesh in check. How many of you know that you and I, every day, whether you smoke cigarettes, drink too much coffee, drink a sip of whiskey, or have a glass of wine, or you get drunk, or whatever crazy things you do out there, that's not good for your flesh. You know, some of you have diabetes and you eat sugar like it's going out of this world. All of the crazy things, the thoughts that our flesh have. But the Bible said there is a crown if you keep your flesh in check. And then there's a crown of rejoicing. And that's a soul winner's crown. I know I'm going to get that. I know because I've led so many people to Jesus Christ. Personally, group settings. You know, I remember his dad was preaching a crusade, and the first person they came to him was deaf and dumb, never heard a sound in his life, only, could make noises like that. He never heard it. And God opened his ears. He gave him to me. He said, Daddy, get him talking. Get him over there and get him talking. And there's this miracles after miracles of people coming to know the Lord. Those are fun to be in. Those are exciting. There was an American lawyer that was with us. Can anything come good out of a lawyer? Any of your lawyers in here? And he was sitting there praying in tongues. And the guy next to him, who couldn't speak English, got somebody to interpret that lawyer. He said, you just told me about Jesus, and would you lead me to him? You see, there's miracles if you'll let them happen. Now, and there's another crown called the crown of righteousness. And that's a crown that I know I'm going to get because I've been looking for Jesus to come since 1957. There's a crown of life. That's a martyr's crown, people that have to die. And listen, around the world, people are dying as a Christian. And who knows, we might have to die before it's over with. Now, I'm not anxious to get that. And if I look at you, you're not either. Okay? But it, so be it if it happens. And then the last one is the crown of glory. That's a crown for ministers, pastors like Pastor Trey, myself, and others that's been faithful. You know, when God called me to preach, I hadn't shut up since. Are you listening to me? When God puts an anointing on you, don't shut up. Just keep on doing it. Just keep on doing what you have to do. Now, today I'm going to talk to you about a heavenly city. Now, like I say, I hadn't talked, I really have not heard a message fully on the heavenly city. I preached on the rewards so I could talk about that deputy sheriff, you know, the coffin down there. And I talked about the rewards. Mickey Stevenson, it was. And so I talked about the reward. Mickey and I had many good conversations about the Lord. And there's rewards for serving Jesus. But you don't hear too many sermons called heaven. You don't hear too much about heaven. And so if you will, take your Bible and let's look at John 14. Now, when Jesus was getting ready to leave, he made some promises. He said, now, there's something getting ready to take place. He told his disciples, let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. He said, in my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. He said, I go to prepare a place for you. And this is, I like it now, this. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will. Say, I will. Say, I will. Come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, you may be also. And whether I go, you know, in the way you know. Thomas, I think, asked a good question. We don't know. Tell us. You don't come on, teach us. How many of you know you can sit in church and not learn until one day you get enough knowledge? You go, whoa, I understand that. And Jesus said this. I bet you Thomas remembered this, Pastor. He said, I am the way, the truth, and the life, and no man come to the Father but by me. He didn't say he was a way, a truth, a life, because there could be another one. And listen, listen, people out there are fighting that today. Secular people are mad when we say those kind of things. But he is life. But he said, I'm going to prepare a place for you. Now, there's three things I want to catch your attention with today. Now, heaven is going to be out of this world. Now, literally speaking, it will be out of this world. You know, one day it'll come, the New Jerusalem is set right here on the earth, but it's out of this world. The Bible says that heaven's on the sides of the north. You know, we point up, whichever way is up for us. You know, we'll point up, heaven's up. But heaven's, the Bible says, is on the sides of the north. It'll be out of this world. Jesus is preparing it right now. How can we be sure that we're going to be there? Well, the Bible says, marvel not at us saying to you, you must be born again. That if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus and shalt believe in thine heart that God raised him from the dead, it says thou shalt be saved. In other words, you must be born again. I remember I went to a service and the guy used to kind of get out and run around and do sin with. I set bowling pins with him back in my young, probably 12, 13 year. I remember if you let the ball go back first before you got the pin and the disc down, forget about the automation today. Those drunk bowlers, by the time they played one round, they're drunk, they throw that ball back at you while you're in there. You have to be smarter than the thing you're doing. Are you listening to me? And so consequently, I think about some of the funny things. And that preacher, he turned to preacher before I did, Charlie Wisdom, great missionary, great man of God, and he told me about Jesus. And I want you to know, I gave my heart to Jesus, and I have been radically born again for 63 years of my life. And I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God and the salvation to all that believe. And then what is heaven really like? Well, I'm going to try to give you the opportunity to understand what heaven's like. Do y'all ever take time to read the end of the Bible? You ever take time to read Revelation 21, 22? Do you ever take time to go all the way to the end of the book? Do you ever take time? Some people start at the end so they know how it ends. Are you listening to me? A lot of times, if you want to, just go to the end of the book. Last chapter will tell you what the book's about. Isn't that right? I mean, you don't have to do all that reading. Just go to the last chapter. You know, just read the last chapter. And how do you think I pass school sometimes? You follow what I'm talking about. You got to be smarter than the thing you're doing. Now, today I'm going to the best of my knowledge and the ability, I'm going to reveal heaven to you. I'm going to call this the mysteries of heaven. Now, a mystery in the New Testament means a truth that God had hid in himself but revealed. And Paul was the one that he revealed all the mysteries to. Now, you study the mystery of the church, just all of those mysteries. I think there is actually 27 mysteries mentioned. And so, but there's a mystery of heaven. What is heaven going to be like? Now, I'm not getting a busload today, but who knows? Somebody might go. And I'll guarantee you, in the city of Galveston or Texas City or Galveston County, somebody will die today. Really, Pastor? Well, just read the newspaper every now and then. Look on the phones. People die. I mean, you know, people die. Okay, I'm not getting a busload. I'm not an undertaker, so I'm not getting ready to take you out of here. You follow what I'm talking about? So consequently, we're going to understand that. When I was very young, I used to be young. I'm 82 years old. I used to be young. How many of you know you have to be young before you can get old? You know, I know that's a real hard, real positive statement. And so consequently, when I was about 19 or 20 years old, they let me teach Sunday school. And you know, I thought I studied hard, and I was studying about God is all-seeing and all-knowing, and he's everywhere, he's omnipresent. And so consequently, I thought I'd really studied that lesson. And I asked the class, I said, is there anything that God cannot see? And now, so out of all the students there, all the kids, you know, adolescent age, that's a preteen. How many of y'all can remember preteens? I can't. And so consequently, I got some good answers. And this one boy, he raised his hand. He said, I can tell you that God cannot see my sins through the blood of Jesus Christ. If you ever understand, once you're forgiven, God can never see your sins again under the blood of Christ. In other words, you're washed white as snow, past, present, and into the future. The Bible says, you know, you need to repent and come to know the Lord. But listen, repenting of lying and cheating and hate and all that kind of stuff is the source of what you do. But what brings you to Christ is to repent that you have never accepted Jesus as your personal Savior. You know, when I got saved, they didn't ask me to give up my sins. Thank God for that. We'd have been there an hour. Well, come on, don't shout me down. Well, not me. And you're lying out your teeth. You know it. So consequently, here's what I did. The preacher said this. He said, I want to present to you Jesus Christ. And if you will accept him into your heart and believe that he died and rose again on the third day, he says, y'all should be saved. And you know what happened to me on that night? I gave my heart to Jesus Christ. I was radically saved, really radically saved. I'm still pretty radical, but I don't get around as much. Are you listening to me? And the one thing I noticed after that, I had to start repenting of my lying. I had to start repenting of my cheating. I had to start repenting of all the lust that I had. I had to repent of all that crazy junk that you put into your life. And I want you to know I'm still repenting. Well, you're not talking to me, Pastor Daddy. I'm talking to every one of you. Every day you're having to fight some kind of issue in your life. Now, y'all are kind of a stiff-necked bunch of people. Y'all better start listening. What happens to you when you get in a crowd like that? They're all guilty. Well, Pastor Daddy, let's move on. Okay. Now, we're going to talk to you about the mystery of heaven, the city. God said, I go to prepare a place for you. If I go and prepare a place for you, he said, I'll come again, receive you unto myself, that where I am, there you may be also. Do you understand that God's going to go take us to heaven until he gets through with it? In other words, he's preparing a place for you and I. Now, not many people today are raised in the country lifestyle. They're not raised in farming and ranching and that type of stuff. Trey's grandmother, my first wife, who is deceased, she was raised on a cotton farm in Central Texas. Her family were the sharecropping people. They had large families. They had, I think it was 9 of them all together, one passed, and they all picked cotton. How many of you know that's hard work? How many of you have ever been in a cotton field? All right, there's a few of you been out there. You know what that's all about. Thank God for the inventions of tractors and different machines that can do all that kind of work for us today. But there was a time, there was a lifestyle. I remember when I joined the Navy in 1955, went to Great Lakes, Illinois. And there I met, of course, you meet the people that's in your company there. And there was one young man that was there from the Bronx. And he come to me, he said, do you down in Texas? He said, do y'all wear cowboy hats? I said, you bet. He said, do y'all wear boots? He said, yes. I said, yes, sir. Yes, sir, we wear boots. Big old buckles. I got a few big buckles. And so consequently, he said, have you ever seen a real cow? I said, we laugh at that. I said, absolutely, I've ate a few. Now, listen, you know what fresh chicken was for us when we was kids? That chicken was out there in the coop. And on Sunday, we didn't go to church. On Sunday, we go out to our grandfather, and he said, come on out here, kids. They're going to show you how to have fresh chicken. Now, I know y'all probably won't like this. He went and got the chicken, and he went, poof! He said, come on over here. Got butcher knife. Pow! And Grandma had a big old pot of water. Throw that dude in there. And he said, now, kids, when it gets done, you're going to pull feathers. How many of you know there was a reward for doing all I did? Because we had fried chicken. How many of you know fried chicken is good? Now, you know, some of y'all don't even know what country is all about. You don't even understand it. How many of y'all have ever killed a rabbit and skinned it? How many of you ever killed birds and, you know, clean them? All right, see, people think, kids think today food comes from a grocery store. But it doesn't. It comes from a source. Grow some tomatoes. Grow some things for your kids so they can see it. So rural living is disappearing. There's a new data out that I read recently says that 60% of the world population will be living in the city by the year 2020. So rural living is really disappearing. Now, with that information, it is not surprising for us today that we're going to learn that God is building the city for all who has and will accept him in the future. Accept Jesus as your Savior. In other words, there's a time that you need to give up your lifestyle and say, Jesus, I'm going to live for you. Now, it's not necessarily popular, but as you know, I got rid of all of my old friends. I either led them to the Lord or stopped running with them. Now, 11 times in Revelation 21 and 22, you'll find the city described that God is building. It's not some idea. It's not some dream place. But it's actually a city called the New Jerusalem. And Paul called it in Galatians, he said it's a Jerusalem above. Have you ever just looked at the word Jerusalem? It's spelled J-E-R, and in the middle of it, it's U-S-A-L-E-M. Do you think that's an accent about some things? We used to be a godly nation. We used to send the missionaries out to the world. We used to serve the Lord. We used to go to church. But we're getting more and more where that's not our lifestyles anymore. Now, we can see that the city of my God, which is New Jerusalem, in Revelation 3, verses 12, in the last part of that verse, it says, the city of my God, which is New Jerusalem, which comes down out of heaven from my God. And Jesus said, I go in to prepare a place for you. Some call it mansion, is that what I call it? But remember now, after the tribulation, Satan is bound for 1,000 years. And the wicked are removed from off the earth. And there's a temple built, they're going to be built at Jerusalem. That will be the highest place on earth at that time. And Jesus will rule, and he'll rule, because when we come back in Revelation 19, we'll be saying this, King of kings, Lord of lords, King of kings, Lord of lords, King of kings, Lord of lords. I don't know how to ride a horse, but I tell you, I'm going to have me a white one that day. And I'm going to be there, and Jesus is going to be out there in the front. We won't have to do anything. We'll just be saying, come on, can you say it? King of kings. Come on, say it. King of kings, Lord of lords. Come on, say it. King of kings, Lord of lords. King of kings, Lord of lords. And I want you to know we're going to come back and see Jesus defeat the Antichrist, defeat all the wicked, and the wicked be removed. Satan will be removed. And you and I will rule in righteousness with him. You know, I've been around a lot of wicked people because, you know, when you do what I've done, there's a lot of wicked people out there. And some of them are just really wicked. And I've been around it. But in the millennium, I'm going to rule in righteousness. And I'm going to rule on earth. And you, Jerusalem, going to come down out of heaven right above the earth. And that's going to be my bedroom. I mean, you know, it's good to go home at night. Come on, y'all are about the stiffest neck people I've preached to in a long time. I can't even say a joke and you laugh. You just... take your mask off so I can get your face. All right, now, excuse me, I didn't mean to say that. Now, we can see, what is Jesus doing now? Remember, he constructing the place. It will be a place large enough for all of the believers, past and into the future. and present right now. How can you build a city big enough to hold all the believers from all the ages, past and future? You might say, how many believers would that be? I don't know. I just know there's a number. And when that number is true, we're going to be called out of here. There's a number for the church. And when that number is fulfilled, we'll be raptured out of here. Remember now, the Bible says not everyone that says, Lord, Lord, will enter in. Heaven will be the most wonderful place you and I could describe. In other words, it'll be beyond that. The Apostle John, the Revelator, wrote, and you can look at this if you want to, in Revelation 21, verses 15 and 16, this is how it reads. And he said, and he that talketh with me had a golden reed to measure the city and the gates thereof and the walls thereof. And the city lies four square, and the length is as large as the breadth. And he measured the city with a reed, 12,000 furlongs. The length and the breadth and the height are equal thereof. The city is so great and so large, and to the best of my ability, I'm going to seek to describe it to you. In other words, I'm going to tell you what I read and how I think it would be described. I'm going to have to give you comparison for you. And I looked in commentaries to get all this information. I don't think I'm quite smart enough to add all these things, and I'm not a mathematician. So to encompass an area, it'd be 140 square miles. The city's first floor will be 2,250,000 square miles. That's just the first floor. You can compare it to cities. Now, cities are beautiful until you have to live downtown in the cities. That's not so pretty. Unless you get a condo in downtown Houston, downtown, something that's real nice. I'd rather live out in the suburban or out in the country. So to compare it to some of the city, it's 20 times bigger than New Zealand. It's 10 times bigger than Germany. It's 10 times bigger than France and 40 times bigger than England. It's a continent in and of itself, because when it's measured out, it equals to the continent of India. It's big. Say it's big. Now let's say it like this. It's big. That sounds better. How many of y'all are in the South now? Say it. It's big. All right. Real good. It's 100,000 million of all the cities of the world today. All the cities now on earth are only a village compared, the commentary said, to the size. It's a city four square. We could say that it's out of this world big. We can only imagine. When they come out with that song and that movie, I Can Only Imagine. How many of y'all got to see that movie? I Can Only Imagine. When they come out with that song, and I will make reference to I Can Only Imagine a lot, or We Can Only Imagine. I can only imagine. When I study this, and when I teach it, or when I preach it, that is, I'm trying to preach today more, when I think, I can only imagine what it'd be like. How big it'd be. All the cities now on earth are only a village to compare to it. It's a city four square. We could say that it's out of this world, come on, big. Can you say big? All right. That, and I want you to know, we can only imagine. In other words, you can only imagine the size and the breadth and the length and the height. You might ask the question now, how is God going to drop a city that big out of heaven right above the earth? Now, let me say this to all of you. If you don't believe in creation, you're in trouble to start with. If you can't believe Genesis 1, that when he spoke, it was created. If you can't believe all of that, if you can't believe that when God spoke, it was all created. I kind of think of it like this. When I was young, I used to be young one time. When I was in my early 20s, some of those young guys, we'd get together and get talking about this. And we'd talk about creation, how God used his finger, how he spoke. And we'd say this, you know, they were just beginning to really get NASA going in the 60s. And we would talk about space. We'd talk about those things. And we'd say, yeah, you know, one day we're going to go to Mars. And we'd talk and we'd get so excited. And we'd say, you know, we're going to be able to think it, get there. Just think it. Just think about that. You're going to be able to think it and be there. In other words, you're going to have to. It's just finger work for God. Remember, this is only the first four I've described to you. He said his city is four square. It's as long as it is wide, as tall as it is wide and long. It's 1,500 miles square. It's a city. Plus, that size equal to, one of the commentaries said it could equal to 600 stories. And you'd ask the question, what would be the transportation? Well, listen, we'll have a body likened to Jesus. It does not yet appear what we should be like, but when he shall appear, we shall be like him. For we shall see him as he is. In other words, when they describe, when Jesus left, he said, he was on the Mount of Olives. He said, you disciples, he said, I'm going to leave, but I'm going to come back. And the angels come, and he just, whoop, he was gone. And that's how fast it is. I made the statement, my honey over here, Frida, you know, she won't be my honey up there. She'll be my sister. And, you know, I thought about this. I had my first wife was named Doris. I've been married 3 times. You said, wow. But let me tell you something. When you have 2 of them die with cancer, you won't say, wow. Are you listening to me? Amen. Cancer sucks. And I'm a cancer survivor. I've had 45 treatments. And I can tell you cancer sucks. And one good thing about, he said there'd be no marriage or given to marriage in heaven. I think, thank God, I'd have 3 of them might want to kill me. Well, Pastor Dowdy, why don't you keep on preaching? Well, I think about this. I want to go visit Frida. She lives on the 600th floor. I'll say, just 600th floor, I want room 1. I'll be there. In other words, you won't be like you are. If you had to walk to this church, you'd still be walking. Are you listening to me? Transportation will be no problem. We'll be able to get there. Now, the city whose builder and maker is God. It's a cube city, the container of the holies of holies with 20 by 20. That's where the presence of God is. Now, you know, when they destroyed the temple, God removed. In fact, if you read Ezekiel, beginning in verse 1 to verse 20, that's the removal of the presence of God out of the temple. The first 20 chapters of Ezekiel is the removal of the presence of God out of the temple before it was destroyed. Read sometimes. You know, I say this, read the Bible, it might scare the hell out of you. I can't believe you said it. Well, I did. And you know, when Jesus came to the earth, he preached, and the Jews rejected him. By large, the Jews rejected him. But he invited the Gentiles. Say, I'm a Gentile. That's what you are. If you're not born a Jew, you're a Gentile. And he welcomed us in. How many of y'all glad God welcomed us in? Both Jews and Gentiles. And listen, the presence of God was removed in AD 70 out of that temple. And I said this morning, now you remember what I'm saying, and I'm right. You know where the presence of God is? It's in you. It's in you. It's in you and it's in me. Because you can't be saved without the Spirit of God, because the Spirit of God convicts you. And then when you give your heart to Jesus, the Spirit of God comes and lives in you. So the presence of God is in you. It's not in some temple today. It's not in some holies of holies. And you can see the holies of holies were built in a cube. Now, many believe that New Jerusalem was a city likened to the holies of holies. Now, keep in mind that the believer, it's believed that the city will be the dwelling place of God himself. Look at Revelation 21 in verse 3. And I heard a great voice out of heaven saying, behold, the tabernacle of God is with men. I want you to know God will come and be the very presence of heaven itself. What a day that'll be. And the Lamb will be present also, Jesus Christ. And I want you to know the presence of God. And we'll be able to see the presence of God every day or night, if I'm using the term we relate to today. Let's look inside the city for a moment. And let me describe this city. To the unbeliever, when he hears it, he won't believe it. He'll tell you it's symbolic and all that. But listen, I've asked you once, if you can't believe Genesis 1 and the creation, you'll never believe what I'm telling you. In other words, in the beginning was God. If you don't believe that, you're in trouble. Now, in Revelation 21 and 2, it reads like this. It's called a holy city. And I, John, saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down from God out of heaven as a bride adorned for a husband. The Wycliffe Bible Commentary, I looked up several of these. Thank God for the internet. Thank God for all the things that we have. He said, the holy city is one. This is a statement he made. There's no lying, no evil, no shady business deal, no adultery, stealing, or whatever is evil. And I want you to know, it won't ever appear there. Listen, every one of us is guilty every day of fighting off evil thoughts. We fight off jealousy. We fight off hate. We fight off just, you know, lust, both men and women, all the things. We have to fight that stuff every day, but it won't be there because it'll all be removed. It's called a holy city, and every one of person that's in it is holy themselves. You cannot get into that city until you're born again. The material used in the city, let's look at Revelation 21. We'll look at verse 12, 17, 18, 19, 20, and 21. And it says in verse 12, and I heard and had a wall great and high, and had 12 gates, and at the gates 12 angels, and the names written thereon, which are of the 12 tribes of the children of Israel. There's something about the number 12, about the number 7. There's a lot of numbers. It's good to study I can't say it right now. It's good to study numbers, the study of numbers, what they mean in the Bible. Now, remember, these gates are made of pearl. When I was young, my brother owned a shrimp boat, so we used to go out on shrimp boats. We used to, you know, get shrimp. Oh, thank God for shrimp. I still think shrimp's got to be part of heaven, but that's my opinion. But there'd be times we'd go out there to the oyster reefs, and we'd get oysters. And then, you know, being the youngest, they'd give me a little knife that you'd open them things. And, of course, we ate the oysters. Occasionally, you find a pearl. But just think about this now. The gates are a pearl. And I think about this. If the gates are that large and the city is 600 stories, so to say, how big would that archer shell have to be? Think about that. Say it's big. It's just real big. Now, just think about this. There's 12 angels at that gate. They're big. And think about this. There's the 12 tribes marked over those 12 gates. And listen, the children of Israel, some of them was absolutely scandalous. You remember they threw their brother into a pit, old Joseph. Think about it. Now think about this. Now I know all of y'all think y'all just real good. Oh, not me. But how many of you throwed your family in a pit? How many of you have not forgiven your family? How many of you have had evil thoughts about somebody in your family? I'm not going to ask you to raise your hands because every one of you would. You didn't think I could walk, did you? But I'm telling you the truth. Don't you point your finger here. But I think about this. If the 12 gates are named after the 12 tribes of Israel, oh, thank God he loved them and saved them. And he loved you. And he loved you. And he loved you. And I found out he loved me a long time ago. 63 years ago, I was going to hell. I was a sinner and I practiced it. But one day somebody introduced me to Jesus. And I tell you, I repented of not believing in him. And I've been repenting of sin ever since then. Well, not me. I live a perfect life. Well, stop lying. You need to repent of that. And he measured the walls thereof in verse 17. 144 cubits according to the measure of a man, that is, of an angel. And then he gives you the materials of the city. Verse 18. The walls were jasper and pure gold like unto clear glass. Now, my second wife was in the jewelry business, and she sold Mary Kay. She was the queen of Mary Kay sales. In other words, she sold more Mary Kay than anybody else in the world that was in the business 4 years. And how many of y'all seen those bumblebees that you have with Mary Kay? Any of y'all seen them? Well, I'm telling you, they're out of this world beautiful, filled with diamonds and gold. It's just a real costly thing. And so consequently, I've seen gold, and I've seen every one of these. She was in the business, and she said, I won so many rings. She said, I didn't have enough fingers for all of them. And so she started selling them. And then we had a jeweler that we went to that we bought. And I've seen most of all of these precious stones. The foundation, the wall of the city, were garnished with all manner of precious stone. And then in verse 19 and 20, it gives you what kind: jasper, sapphire, chalcedonia, emerald, sardonyx, sardis, and chrysolite, and beryl, and topaz, and I can't pronounce that next one, and janik, and amethyst. And I've seen just about all of those kind of diamonds. When you get in that kind of business, you can see a lot of this stuff. And the 12 gates were pearl, and the streets were pure gold, like in the clear glass. Now, you think you can't see through gold. The 24-karat gold is the most pure of all of it. And you can't see through it. But think about this. Now, the streets are going to be so pure in gold that you can see through it. I can only imagine. I can only imagine. I can only imagine what it'll be like. And I saw no temple therein, for the Lord Almighty and the Lamb are the temple of it. In other words, the presence of God will be there. I'll use the term 24/7. That's a term we understand. We can only imagine what it will be like. A 12-layer foundation of all these stones, all of them mixed together. Now, it'll be like the color of a rainbow. Now, not the one for, homosexuality. It'll be the color of the rainbow of God. You know, one day, I think I was with my honey here, Frida. We saw a rainbow. We saw it over here. And I said, honey, have you ever been to an end of a rainbow? And she said, no. I said, let's drive. And we drove all the way over. And where the rainbow ends, we drove into that rainbow. Rainbows are absolutely beautiful. I can only imagine what it will be like. The colors, the brilliancy of all of that stuff. Remember, a city is only strong in this foundation. Let's think about the lights of the city. In Revelation 21, verse 11, 23, he says, having the glory of God, and her light was likened to the stones most precious, even like jasper stones, clear as crystal. You'll be able to see through it, and yet you'll be able to walk on it. In verse 23, the city had no need of the sun or the moon to shine in it, for the glory of God did lighten it, and the Lamb is the light thereof. There'll be no pose. You look at the pictures over in Louisiana when we had our storm of Ike, and I can remember Alicia, and I lived long enough to go through Carla, Alicia, Ike, and I hope I live long enough maybe not to see no more. There'll be no pose. There'll be no wires. There'll be none of that. I can only imagine what a city like that will be like. It will be the fulfillment of what Isaiah said in 69:19. It says, this is the prophet that he said, the sun shall be no more, thy light by day, neither for the brightness shall thy moon give her light unto thee, but the Lord shall be unto thee an everlasting light, and thy God thy glory. Paul said it like this in 1 Corinthians 2:9. He said, but as it is written, eye has not seen, nor ear heard, neither have it entered into the heart of man the things which God had prepared for them that love him. In other words, I can only imagine. I can only imagine what it'd be like. Now, at my age at 82, I'm probably a candidate to go there sooner than you. If life just plays out, I might can get 90. And pre-adventure, I might get a little bit more. But, listen, it'll play out on you. And I've already having some issues of playing out on some things. But see, you're gonna go there one day. You're going to be in the presence of God. Now, Let's look at the food and the healing of it. Let's look at Revelation chapter 22 and verse 2. He says, in the midst of the street and on either side of the river was the tree of life, which bare 12 banners of fruit and yielded a fruit every month. And the leaves of the fruit were for the healing of the nations. In other words, it's going to be massive. And there is a river that flows down from the throne of God. And on each side of it will be these trees. It has been pointed out that we are to be able to eat of the tree mentioned in Genesis 1. And there'll be no prohibition. In other words, what Adam ate, that tree will be there and we can eat it. And there'll be no prohibition. There'll be trees there. And we can go eat the leaves of the tree for the healing. Some of you have been really sick. Some of you, Trey's father passed away with cancer. We've had to suffer a lot from cancer. You know, in July 2012, his father, my oldest son, he died of cancer. 2 days later, one of my grandsons, just younger than him, he's the oldest, his wife and three kids were killed in a car accident, head-on car accident, and the car caught fire. So in 2 days, I had prepared for two funerals of five of my loved ones. And I want to tell you, that's one of the hardest things I ever done. It was harder than going through cancer treatment. But thank God they're all saved. And I get to see them. Listen, as I get older and they see the frailness of my life, my grandchildren come and tell me. They come and tell me, say, Grandpa, thank you for giving your heart to Jesus. Because we're saved. Amen. And it keeps passing down. When you live for Christ, you can have a good family. Now listen, we're a crazy mixed up family. You put us together and we can be Dowdies for sure. We can be Kenworthies for sure. You understand, you put us all together as a family, we can be wild. But it's a good wild. Now, we can see that this time we'll not have to get into trouble when we eat a tree. In Revelation 20, let's look at verse 1 and 2. And he showed me a pure water of life, clear as crystal, proceeding from the throne of God and of the Lamb. In the middle of its street, on either side, a river was the tree of life, which bore 12 fruit trees. The leaves was for the healing. And finally, in closing now, we will find out how much God really loves us. You know, with the COVID and with all the restrictions and everything that's going on, now I still do jail services. I still do the ministry the best I can right now. But there's times that you get a little depressed. And either last Monday, turn that thing off or tell God he can call you later. I think it was Monday or Tuesday, or it was either Tuesday or Wednesday. One day, I was extremely emotional. I had to fight myself to keep from crying, to keep from feeling sorry for myself. I did my best to be in front of my wife, a good person. I went to bed. I cried a lot that night. Because sometimes that does not ever look like all of this mess will ever end. But when I woke up, I realized how much God loved me. And I said, oh, God, forgive me. I'm feeling sorry for myself. How many of you know God's there? Forgiveness is right away. It's right away. I don't want to end with a negative, but I want to give you this thought. Denzel, you come up here if you will. And you that's going to help me if you want to come up. But in Revelation 21, verses 8 and 27, it reads like this. But the cowardly and the unbelieving and the abominable and the murderers and the sexual immorals and the sorcerers And the idolaters and all liars shall have their part in the lake of fire, which burns with brimstone. That's the second death. But there shall be by no means anything that enter into it, anything that defiles or cause any abomination or lie, but only those who are written in the Lamb's Book of Life. You see, in the latter January of 1957, his father nearly died. He was 29 days old, and he had a hernia. And the doctor showed us how to push that hernia back in place and said, we're going to have to wait till he's 6 months. Now, remember, we had one-horse hospitals back in those days. You think of all the trauma hospitals today, but you just jacked this thing back in time. You didn't have what you have today. And that hernia dropped one night. And when that hernia dropped, my wife tried to push it in, and she said, honey, of course, my finger being bigger, she said, see if you can do it. And all the baby, all Trey's dad would do would just cry. He'd cry. So you used to have doctors that used to come to your home. And I called Dr. Reeves, and I said, Dr. Reeves, this is what's going on. He said, Bobby, he said, put him in your car and get him down here. And the hospital was here. There was an alley here. And there was an operating room back in the backside of the bank. You think, I wouldn't even take my child there. When that's all you have, you do what you got to do. And I remember I carried the baby in for Doris. Then I gave Robert to Doris, and she hugged him. She gave him back to me, and I gave him to the doctor or to the nurses. And I said, what do you think? He said, well, he's got probably at least 50-50 chances. And I don't mean to make this emotional for you, but you'll face life sometimes, and life is tough, and it throws you curves. And you'll lose loved ones. And you'll cry. And remember, we didn't have these telephones. You had pay phones. And it was about midnight or 1 o'clock. And we didn't have that good of cars in those days. And I told Doris, I said, we won't call a family. We'll just sit here, you and I. We'll sit here. And I sit on a waiting bench, and Doris next to me. And tears was in my eyes. And we sat there. We had to think about our lives. And listen, when there's death of a child, the hardest death I faced in my life is my son. You understand, when you lose your children, that's, to me, it's the hardest death. All of them's hard. And I sit there and I bowed my head and I didn't know how to pray. And I said, God, please don't let him die. And I remember crying a little bit. And I consoled my wife the best I knew how. And then I said to myself, if there really is a God, because I called on you just then, I want you to show me yourself. Now the son lived. He lived to be in his 50s. And the preacher come by. I went to visit my mother and daddy. My wife and I took the baby over there. It happened to be my mother and daddy. My daddy wasn't going to church, and he started going. And the preacher come by and visit. And he talked to my dad, but when he looked at me, he said, Bobby, would you come go to church Sunday? And I said, I believe we will. And and it's having a revival. My wife was a telephone operator, so she had to work. She worked from, you know, 1 to 10 or whatever that time was. And I was taking care of Robert. And I went in, and people were so gracious to me. They took care of my baby good. And I sat as far back in that Baptist church. The churches used to be long. And if it was any further back out, I'd have been on the street. Because I was scared. And I remember Charlie Wisdom, who became a great missionary. And I used to set bowling pins with him. We used to run the streets, and we was into no good a lot of times. And he got saved first and had the call of God in his life. And you know what he told me about? He didn't tell me about my sins. He told me about Jesus. He didn't tell me I had to repent of my sins. He told me about Jesus. And we used to play "Just As I Am" without one plea. Those songs in the Baptist church, and we used to sing at invitation. And when he began to play that music, or they did, I got up as far back as I was. And I walked down and I stood in front of Charlie. Him and I was rascals at times. You know, we're just kids trying to grow up. And he said, "Bobby, here's what he said to me. He didn't ask me to confess my sins. He said, Bobby," that's what they called me in my younger days. My name is Robert, but it's Bobby. "He said, would you like to accept Jesus? He died for your sins." And he quoted the scripture that if thou shalt confess with thy mouth and believe in thine heart that God raised Jesus from the dead, thou shalt be saved. For with the heart man believeth unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. I said, "Yes, Charlie." And he got me bowed my head, and I prayed. He prayed, and I prayed after. I was gloriously saved. I went home. I left there and went and picked my wife up. And I told her, "Honey, I got saved." And within a couple of weeks, she gave her heart to the Lord. Now listen, we both come from families that didn't go to church. She had eight. I had four. There was five of us and eight of them. We heard a preacher preach one time. The Philippian jailer, he said, "What must I do to be saved, Paul?" He said, "Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and you'll be saved in your whole household." We heard that message. We come home one night, kneel down beside the bed. And we said, "Jesus, we want all of our family to be saved." And one by one, they came to know Jesus. I'm going to get to see all those rascals. But today is your opportunity. I want you to bow your head for just a minute. How many of you today will firmly raise your hand up and say, "I'm a believer. I have accepted Jesus Christ"? Just lift up your hand, one or the other. Father, thank you so much. Thank you for all those hands. Now put your hand down. Now, if you do not know Jesus today and you really want to be saved, would you just lift your hands? Anybody in the house today, you say, "Pastor, would you pray for me?" Just anybody. Anybody. Here's one over here. Yes, sir. Okay. Anybody? Here's something back there. I want you to pray with me and ask Jesus into your heart. Let's pray like this. All of you pray out now. Dear Heavenly Father, I thank you for your son, Jesus. I receive him into my heart today. I believe he died for my sins. And he was raised on the third day. And because he lives, I will live also. Thank you, Father. Now, I've asked Danzel, let's sing it. All of you stand up a minute. All of you stand up. We're going to sing that song, "I Can Only Imagine." And Danzel can sing it better. When I do die, son, you're going to sing this song. You're going to singing, son.